Okay, hi, this is Ginger Cook. I am live from downtown, well, not downtown, I'm out in the suburbs of Houston, Texas. And I want to welcome everybody to Ginger Crumbs. You know, we do a lot of different live shows here on YouTube. This one is a very short, kind of fast tip that's something you can, you know, take home tonight and remember tomorrow. Nothing's going to be too complicated. But we're going to show you something that's going to be helpful. And I think if you watched our ads, we thought it would be useful to tell you a little bit more about this color wheel, what you can do with it. Why would you want one? Who has a color wheel? Why do I want one? And will it help me? And of course, the answer is yes, you want one and it will help you. So I'm going to show you how. Now, our moderator, John Little, who is also the partner in GingerCookLive.Gallery, if you're new, you may not know what that is, but but basically what we are is an online art academy. We have lots of lessons we add 3 new lessons every week. There's over, I think we're way over 50 lessons, you guys, now that are available for our subscribers. And what's fun about it is that you can send me your artwork if you become a member, and I will critique it and send it back. Sometimes it takes a day or two, and usually on weekends it takes a little longer because I work a lot of weekends, but you get it back from me and you get help, and we really see some great improvement that way. So today we're talking about the color wheel and why you'd want one. So let's just move the Ginger Cook crumb sign. I want to thank Brandon in Houston at Jerry's Artorama for making me this nifty sign. Come on, you guys, that's really neat, right? We're going to move the sign, and I'm going to talk to you, and let's zoom in here. This is a little painting I did. We're not going to do the whole thing tonight, but I'm going to show you that when I was doing this painting, I used a color wheel to figure out what colors I should use to fill this in. Now, I didn't make this just up off the top of my head. I was on the internet, and I was looking for something bright and colorful that would demonstrate it. And there was a photographer who had taken a photograph of some colored pencils, and he probably arranged them in a way that he felt was helpful. And I'm sure he probably, you know, used a lot of the rules that we're going to talk about tonight in using a color wheel. But I thought we could even expand a bit more on this, all right? So what I did was I went ahead and created this small painting. It's on a 6x8 canvas. You're zooming in, right? And we're going to talk about why this is, you know, what makes some paintings just want to jump out at you. What is it about the colors that just sort of really resonate with you? Why do some work and some don't? Here's another example of a painting I have done based on a color wheel, okay? So when you look at that, you'll see you know, warm and cool colors. But how did I come to these things? And I mean, this is going to be, it makes so much sense to you when I tell you. So tonight, just to have the fun of it, right, what we're going to do is I'm going to show you a couple things. How to use the color wheel and how to make a colored pencil. I'm going to show you how we paint one of those pencils. Eventually, this has been a recorded lesson. The entire lesson will be on our website in a few weeks, how to do that painting. But I'm going to show you just a trick if you just want to do something fun with me tonight while we're learning. How's that sound? So let's put out, this is a little canvas. Everybody says, where do you get these canvases? I get these at Jerry's Artorama. It's a Paramount canvas. Art Wholesale Supply sells them too. There's 10 sheets. They're real canvas sheets and a tablet. They're very handy to draw, to paint on. And we're going to just do a few colors tonight. We're going to do white, purple, phthalo blue, cad red, medium, and yellow. Just to make, we're going to do something real quick. And if you happen to have artist tape, I want you to get some. If you happen to have some artist tape, that would be good. I want you to get some of that. And here's some cad red, cad yellow medium, and we want some cad red medium too. I kind of mixed those up. I did them backwards, but that's my dyslexic self here. So I put the yellow here and the red here, but that's okay. This is cad red medium. This is an orange red. We're going to do a phthalo blue. Phthalo blue is like a turquoise blue. Think of both of these as starting with the letter P, Pacific Ocean. It's the color of the Pacific Ocean. Ultramarine blue is the color of the Atlantic, and blue jeans and all that stuff. So here's some phthalo blue. And we want to do also a little dazzling purple. If you get that, we're in good shape. People say, well, gosh, you can mix purple. Why do you want purple? Dazzling is an ingredient that makes the purple. You can't get it this bright. This is a great purple. If you just don't own this, this would be something to pick up at the art store. And I would recommend either Matisse structure, golden paint acrylics, or Liquitex heavy body. Those are, for me and my feeling about it, those paints will give you the best colors. Okay, anytime the red costs more than the white, you're in good shape. Okay, so let's just take our canvas here, and we're just going to do a little vignette here. I'm going to just show you this. We're going to take some purple, okay, maybe some cad red medium, and let's just take a big brush and paint the whole canvas this color. Just kind of, I'm using a filbert brush. It's a number 8, I think, and I'm just, but any brush will do that. You can kind of, you know, could use anything. See, here's a little red on here too, a little red and purple. We're gonna do that, and just kind of this dark canvas, I'll take a little more purple like that, and I'm just gonna cover this canvas pretty easy, just back and forth, no water. You see how it's getting kind of dark here, and there's a little bit of a red tint to it. And then what we're gonna do is dry it, and then I can go to plan B. Now I'm gonna just kind of scrape off the excess. And I got quite a bit on there. I don't know if you saw that, John. I got quite a bit on there. So I'm going to take a little palette knife because I want this to dry. And I'm just going to see if I have to scrape up anything extra, put it back on the plate, and then I'll finish painting that because I don't want any high spots on this. I want to dry it. Now, whenever you're drawing something, hold the hairdryer pretty close to what you're drawing. Not very far away. You know, don't touch the picture, but as close as you can get without touching it. Okay? And what happens to this brush? Now it goes in water and it gets to be, we're going to dry it. Then we're going to take, I'll use the back of another brush to hold this down. And have you guys seen my nifty new hair dryer? Has anybody seen the nifty new hair dryer that I painted recently? Is this cool or what? I put Starry Night on my hair dryer. So John is going to just, so, you know, you're not going to hear the hairdryer because we're going to just kind of mute it while I start. After 1, 2, 3, it's going to get quiet. All right? Ready? 1, 2, 3. You start. Okay, that should be pretty dry. I always give my stuff a blast of cold air afterwards to make sure that it's dry. You kind of hit that cold air button on the hairdryer. Somebody, you know, one of the things we do on Mondays on Ginger Crumbs is we answer questions that have been asked. So the question we're asking is, what good is a color wheel? Why would you want one? Why do I want to own one? And I can't say enough things about owning a color wheel, okay? Really can't. This is a small one. It's called a pocket color wheel. It comes, not only this, the inside of it has a grayscale on it, which is very handy too, for you can tell if something's up, you know, then we can talk about that in another video, how to use this grayscale. But basically you have three main colors. You may have learned that in school, primary colors. That's your red, yellow, and blue, okay? But then you've got all these other colors on the color wheel. You've got, you know, you've got red, you've got red orange, you've got orange, then you've got yellow orange and yellow green, and blue green and blue, and then blue violet and violet, and then you've got over here, the last one, sort of a red violet, okay? So basically, for instance, if you add a little yellow to green, everybody knows, or a little, you know, yellow to green, it becomes a little lighter. If you add a little blue to green, it becomes a little darker. You add a little red to violet, or purple, it gets lighter. So, I mean, that's kind of obvious. I mean, I figure most of you know that. But what I want to address today is complements. Complements are the colors that are directly across from each other on a color wheel. And you don't have to memorize them, though it's not that much to learn. But, purple is right across from yellow. Do you see that? So if you have something, if you have a very bright yellow and you needed to tone it down a bit, suppose you were doing a daffodil and you wanted a little shadow on the daffodil. Well, you could use a yellow orange as a shadow, but also you could add a touch of purple to your yellow, and that would tone it down. Conversely, if you have a really bright purple, if you add a little bit of yellow to it, it would tone it down. So the farther things are in the background in a landscape, the more subdued the colors are, the grayer they are. So that's when your complements come in handy, because you can use your complements to sort of fade out colors. Now in a painting like this, the garden steps, you remember in one of our lessons, we talked about how to how to get the perspective on these. But what I did was I used this color wheel because here's the thing. Besides having warm and cool colors, for instance, turquoise is right opposite orange. So you can see here that I've got this sort of, these beautiful orange flowers, and I'm getting into these sort of turquoisey greens back here. Got a little blue here. Purple is opposite yellow, so you'll notice that that we've got purple shadows, and then we've got sort of kind of off yellow, kind of yellow highlights on the steps, all right? And then, for instance, red is opposite green on the color wheel, so when you take some bright red flowers and put it against dark green, that makes this pop. And again, if you think about your color wheel. Now the other thing I was able to use with this, I'll show you another color wheel in a minute. So basically, if you want something to pop, use the complements. Now in this picture, for instance, what do we notice? That we notice that we have this large turquoise blue pencil, and it's sitting right next to an orange pencil, okay? And we have a yellow pencil sitting next to a purple pencil, okay? And we have, for instance, here's some green pencils, and I purposely put them next to red pencils. Now, if you can have some pink, and then you can go into violets, and you can do sort of harmonious colors like that. But when you do a few of these opposites, like this, opposite the color wheels, that makes the pictures sort of stand out a bit, okay? So I didn't, for instance, put any yellow over here, so these purples are kind of by themselves, okay? But the yellow up here really shows up, besides it's going against the dark, but also because it's going against purple. And I've got a little bit of, and I've got this turquoise surrounded by two pencils that are orange, all right? So I thought this was really fun to paint. I thought this was a hysterically fun one to paint. And let's see, here we go. Here's our picture. So I'm going to show you while we're talking about this and complements and why you want to do that. And we can talk even about unity colors. Let's take this is called a white white charcoal pencil, and I think I want a ruler, and I want to say that here's one of the deals. We're going to do some long pencils here. I want the point to be here, and I want the pencil to end here. So now I'm going to take my ruler, and I'm just going to, it doesn't have to be perfectly straight. It can even be at an angle. I don't mind that. I'm going to say here's where I want my pencil to go. And is that going to show up? Yeah, so that's as long as I want it. And I probably, how wide do I want it? Well, I want it about quarter of an inch wide, like this. So if I'm coming over here like this, about a quarter of an inch wide. If I come up here like this and put my ruler like this, I can do it. That's one way to do it. This certainly works. I mean, you can't fault this. And we're going to show the end of a pencil. What does the end of a pencil look like? It's kind of round, so we'd kind of tilt it this way, okay? And then we're going to say that there's a, maybe starting back here a little bit, this is going to a point like that. There's a pencil I might want there. Maybe I've got another one that I'm going to say it's coming along here like this, and comes to a point. Maybe it's a little shorter, okay? So I've got another one here. Let's just do three pencils. How's that? Now you can do as many as you want, but you'll get the idea. You can design something, maybe put some colored pencils on the table or something and look at it. So, all right, so here's our three colored pencils. One time I saw a really beautiful painting, which was sort of long and skinny, kind of like this. And it was all makeup pencils. It was about 10 of them all going this way, and it was like, you know, really big, like 36 inches wide. And I loved the artist that did it. A friend of mine, John Douglas, painted it. And I just would have bought it from him because it so reminded me of all the pencils and makeup for all the law that we women use. I thought it was sort of fun. Now, of course, now we could just paint those in. But here's a little trick. You can take some tape. This is, I'll just measure it for you right now. This is the quarter inch tape, and I'm gonna come out here like this, and I'm gonna tape it in the middle like this, and then I'll take a little palette knife. That's one of the tricks with tape. Let's just find a little palette knife. And I'm just gonna end it right here. I don't have to go too far. Okay, and I'm gonna say that there's my, that's my first pencil, okay? So then all you have to do, this is for those of you who just feel straight lines are beyond you. We did a little bit of tape with a spoon the other day that was sort of fun. So now I'm going to come up with this thinner tape. This is a 1/8 inch tape. And we're going to do something on either side of this. All right. Like that. I guess we're going to do it right about like this on either side. Like that. And then I'm going to, let's see, I think I need this to stop right. This one to stop right. Come on, didn't mean to make that go down. Either had to make that longer or shorter. Okay, so we're going to stop this one right about here. This is where a palette knife comes in handy. You can just, you know, hold it down. You need a pretty good long piece to do this, but I think this will work there. It sort of took that off. Now I'll take the middle piece out like this. Take the middle piece tape out. So if you didn't want to draw this all in, you could just happily, you know, paint it in like this. If you didn't want to draw it all in, this is how wide we're going to say the first pencil is. And then because we did it against something dark and we're doing it small, I'll take a small little brush. Let's see, what do I have that's a little smaller than this? I've got... I love it. I just had all these little brushes that I had that was smaller than that. You know, when they're short, they go in the can and then I don't see them. Okay. I'll do this one. This is a 3/8 inch brush, okay? So we put out the colors. Now, all right, so if I wanted to, this would be a lighter color, I would just take a little white first. And I would paint over it. Now, one of the tricks when you're painting over tape is you always overlap the edges of the tape, but try not to push the paint underneath it. That's a little trick. So I'm going to start there with my first one. It's a little white colored pencil here for now. And then as I come out to the edge here, I'll just, using this angle brush, I'll just point in the, okay, there's the tip of my pencil, okay, like that, and I've kind of rounded the edge right like that. Now, this was where you would just take the hairdryer, but I guess before we dry it, we can do the wooden part. So let's take a little yellow, I'm going to show you how this works, and a little purple, okay, now, and a little tiny bit of cad red medium. All right, good, now a little bit of white. Now I've got this sort of light brown color. See this cool little color I made, sort of this pencil color? And I'm going to come up here like this, and say that this is where it's going to kind of straight across here, and this is where we're going to say that the edge of this end of this pencil is, right like that. And then I'll take a little bit more purple with that and a little bit more cad red medium and make something a little darker as a shadow color. And this is where you want to wipe your brush off if you're using it to mix. And I'm going to say that the, let's see, let's maybe the light's coming down from the top. Let's have the light coming from the left. So we'll make it a little bit darker there. Okay, it's like a little shadow where the wood goes. Might be a little darker underneath. Got to think about those things. Okay, pinch your brush. Okay, so now there's this pencil. Now could I make it longer? Maybe I want it longer. I'm looking at that thinking, you know, it could be a little longer. Maybe I'll make it this long. I want it longer. Here, I'm gonna make it even longer. I'm gonna make it long like this. Okay. So that's my long. That's gonna be my longest pencil. Now here's what you do. You can take the peel of the tape off like this. Now we still are gonna paint some color over it, but I don't want it. I want to go ahead, and I don't want tape on there when I do it. Okay? Does that make sense? But there's my first pencil. All right. Now I can probably do this top one because without having to dry anything, I could do that top one like this. I can take a little piece of tape like this and say, here's my top one. I'm gonna say, here's a pencil. Let's put this brush somewhere on a holder. And let's see, I'm gonna end it right about here. Okay. And I want to end this one right here. Do you see how I'm using the edge of the palette knife to end this right like that? Okay. Now, I'm going to use just the small tape next to it. Now, look, you could have just taped around the stuff that we drew in too, but I'm just trying to show you how you wouldn't even have to draw it in. You could just use tape sort of as your stuff here, okay? Pinch, you know, hold it tight between two fingers when you're doing this, all right? Hold it tight and pull up this. Just pull that right up. It doesn't pull right up. Let's see. Let's take those extra pieces off. So we had a really, I hope everybody had a nice Memorial weekend while we're taking this stuff up. I think this was great fun. We've been busy making new things for our website. For those of you who are watching our live classes, which we hold on Tuesday night at 7:30 Central, a little bit longer painting lesson and stuff. We painted last Tuesday night. We did these young men, these two brothers in a field. Okay, we painted that, and then I guess that was Wednesday afternoon. And then we did the boy on the river, and I showed you how to do sand and everything. That was Tuesday. This was Wednesday, okay? And those are now up on our website, gingercooklive.gallery, okay? So as long as I'm just in the paint, I'm gonna keep going with this brush. I'm gonna keep making a white, just keep making it white because we're painting over something dark and I want this to be pretty bright, these pencils. I'm just going over the white paint. My background isn't completely dry, so it's picking up a little purple. And I'm going to say this one's a little bit smaller, like this. Here's a little bit smaller, a little bit shorter pencil. Okay, and I'm going to kind of round the edge here, like that. Okay, so I'm just saying, and then make sure that you go over the edge of your tape, like that. You want to overlap that tape. That's what I'm talking about. Overlap the tape. So here's a pencil. We're putting this here. And we're just going to take, again, we're just going to tear this tape up. Somebody says, what do you do with this tape? Well, look, it's perfectly good. We only used white. So you could be hanging this around the studio. You could have little pieces of tape hanging everywhere. Because you can, if you only painted white on it, you can use it again. You can recycle it. If you're going to throw it away, my best advice, okay, is to put it, wad it up and dip it in water and then throw it away, and that releases the glue. If you dip it in water and then do it, it won't stick to the waste basket. Okay, so at this point, let's see, I think we can still go back and do a little of this wood color on this one. Okay, because we're still pretty good here. We can come back here and do a little bit of the wood. A little bit of our wood color. That. Now we have to dry it. We can't do any more until we dry it, all right? Everybody's with me on that. So we're going to take our hair dryer real quick and I'm just going to dry this, all right? Okay, so Where are we? Well, we're pretty good. So back to the compliments now. Let's look at our color. We're gonna do three pencils, and we're gonna sit there and say that the other one's gonna be in here, and it's gonna be kind of tucked in behind here like this. Here's our next one, and I think I'll just use the brown color. Do that. This is the one that's gonna be sort of tucked in here, back here like this. Here's our other pencil. All right. And I'm going to just paint this one in. If we're saying that the, you know, turquoise is next to orange, that's some of my favorite color combinations, is turquoise and orange. I mean, I absolutely love that, right? So what I might want to do is say that I'm going to say that I want this one sort of a dark orange color. So I'm going to come under here right over the brown. I can get away with bright dark orange over the brown. This will be not quite so bright once I paint this in. And I'm suggesting that this pencil is sort of tucked in here. Now, if I wanted to make this one on top of the other one, for instance, then I would overlap it. It would depend on how you painted it. But I just wanted to get the idea of how you might paint it. Now, when you come up here like this, there's the top of this, like that. And of course, the tip of the pencil is jaggedy here. There's the tip of the color right there. Okay, now if there's a light source that's coming on top of here like this, so I'm just going to get some yellow and I'm going to put it right up here. I'm going to say this is my lightest part of my pencil. This is just the top part of it. Maybe I'll even do a little white, lighten this up just a hair, because I want this top side to be lighter. And then I want the dark side to be darker. So here's my orange. There we go. Now, what's orange opposite of? Let's just talk about that for a minute. Orange is opposite what on the color wheel? It's opposite blue. So if I took, here's some orange. If I wanted a darker orange, this is something you haven't thought of. If I add a tiny bit of blue to that, look what happens. Look how that darkened this orange. So if I want to say this part of the pencil was in shadow, most people would just reach for brown, wouldn't you? You wouldn't think to take the blue and put it in there, but we're talking about 1%, not a lot. And you get sort of a brown color, that phthalo blue, and you get this sort of rust brown color, almost like a burnt sienna. Okay, and so here's my shadow on this pencil. Do you see how we got that? And how do we know that? You have to remember it? No, you just know that if you want to tone down an orange, you know, you're going to be in the blues, and like in this case, it's the turquoise color, which is sort of the phthalo blue. You know, so there's a range of blues to do that, to tone down an orange, okay? So that's kind of cool. It's cool to know. Now this next pencil I want is a turquoise, all right? I'm going to make this next one a turquoise. So if I want to do that, I'm going to take some phthalo blue and white, and I'm just going to mix a nice kind of bright color here. Now here, I want a little bit more turquoise than that. So I'm going to add a tiny bit of yellow to this. A little tiny bit, like 1%. Maybe a little bit more than that, but not much. Okay? A little tiny bit of yellow. And now here's my turquoise blue color. Alright? So I'm going to say that that's this pencil right here. Now I've gone over white here. And the reason I didn't leave the tape on is sometimes the tape, if you leave the tape on to do this, sometimes the tape makes it look a little bit too mechanical. You know, it just does. So let's make sure we round it off the edge here. Okay, so if you kind of do this, then you sort of relax that. Now at this point we've got, what do we have? We have sort of a flat pencil. It's gonna just say, I'm gonna turn it that way. So now we need a little bit of light for the top of it. Yes, because the here's just a little bit of white to lighten the top of this pencil and bring it around like this. Bring it down. And then let's make a little turquoise edge to our colored pencil here. Hey, do you guys know the story of the pencils? Can I tell them a story? Do I have time to tell them the story of the pencil, John? Oh, he says I have time to tell you the story of the pencil. Okay, this is really a cool story. Did you know the British invented the pencil? The English did? Yeah, long, long time ago, they invented the pencil, and they had the only graphite mine in the whole world, only one. And they felt so strongly about it that they didn't have it on any map, and they strip searched the miners as they were coming out of the mine for pencil lead. And if they caught you, they either hung you, depending on your infraction, or they sent you to Australia, but you were in trouble if you were caught stealing the graphite. Now, this is just pure phthalo blue here, down here at the crack, and then I'm going to just sort of bring it this way a little bit so that I kind of fade that out. So here's my shadow on this one. Now, see, already this is pretty because we put the orange and the blue together, yes? So anyway, so the story was they considered it a weapon of war. Can anybody think? Let's see, not all comment at once. Why it might have been a war weapon. The pencil to the British was a war weapon. And they sold pencils all over the world. In fact, when Napoleon declared war on England, the first thing they did was cut off his pencil supply. I mean, just like that, there was no more pencil. And Napoleon was so distraught that he put out a cry to the vendors of France, and he said, listen, you guys, we're going to lose this war unless we have pencils. Now, you have to be thinking about why that would be important if you don't get us a pencil. So what I need you guys to do is to come up with a pencil, some sort of pencil substitute, or the war is going to be over, okay? Now, here's some yellow. Let's just take some yellow and white maybe for this one. Okay, so here's our yellow pencil. I'm going to say there's a yellow one right here. Okay, so anyway, the French didn't, the only graphite mine in the world was in England. But the French had sort of a kind of graphite, but it crumbled like Swiss cheese, feta cheese. It just all crumbled. So there was this guy, and he was later he became famous for inventing the hot air balloon, all right? And let's see, I've got this a little too long, so I'm just going to shorten it here, and then I'll come back with some dark. All right, so if I want to take a little bit of, see, what's opposite yellow on the color wheel is purple, so if I took a little bit of purple and added it to this color, would that give me a little bit of a shadow color down here at the base for my pencil, maybe a little bit? So, anyway, so what he did was he took the crumbly graphite that they had, and add a little bit of white to my yellow here, show you. And then he took the a big pot, and he got a bunch of dirt and he got some wax and he cooked it and he made the first Conti crayon. All right, so isn't that cool? He made and Conti crayons are used in art store today. So basically, what happened was, he made the first colored pencil, and then everybody figured out wax and dye. I can make my own pencil. I don't need those stupid British, pencils. And so the pencil went from being worth a ton of money. A ton of money to being worth absolutely nothing overnight. I mean, that's how fast it went down in value. Okay. So I share that story with you because I think that's absolutely cool. Now, one thing the British did do with their graphite was they would put it on their cannonballs and they would shoot farther, but that wasn't the reason they considered the pencil this marvelous war weapon, okay? So I'm blending that out, a little bit more shadow on my pencil, and I'm reinforcing some of that orange color, which is sort of picking it up here, which is picking it up here, okay? Then I'll come back with a little bit of the dark color and rearrange our, here, I'm going to just round off the tip of this pencil like that. Oops, too much. Okay, we'll just cut it short here like that, okay? So now you can kind of see how we painted these pencils. Now, let's see, it depends on, let's see, I'm going to put a little bit of this purple right like that here, a little bit for shadow. Okay, something like that. We've got a little shadow on our pencils. Anyway, so now, has anybody commented, John, on why the pencil was considered a war weapon for the British? Have we told everybody why that would be? So a little white. Do a little light tip here. All right, so here's the deal, you guys. Here's why it would be. What did you have to write with? All right, just to try to imagine. All you've got to write with, you know, up until now, is you've got ink or maybe a piece of charcoal. Okay, see my nifty colored pencils and see how we put them in there? Isn't that cool? Now that you know how to do that, you know how we did this, yes? Okay, so, well, all right, so I'm going to write there. Help. Send troops. Okay, so then what happens? Well, if you're using charcoal, it smears, and by the time it gets to high command, nobody thinks you want soup. They don't know what you want. Something. You want something. Or if you're using ink, what happens? Ink runs. And now you really, because it rains over there, right? It rains over there a lot. But if you're using a pencil, it doesn't erase. A pencil just writes. There's no erasing. So you could then, and of course, they probably didn't have a lot of people that knew how to embroider help come quick or whatever. So the pencil was, all the military used pencils in their, as their part of their war effort. And without a pencil, they were doomed. But here Napoleon's guy, Conti, comes along and he invents the Conti crayon. And if you remember, Conti crayons are mud colors. They're this red color, you know, this mud color. And then there's this dark brown Conti crayon. You know, there's a dark brown one. Let me get my little crayons out here and I'll show you. They've got a real dark dirt one. I think if I have any left, I don't think I have any out. But there's like a dark brown one. And then there was a kind of a yellow ochre one, kind of about this color. It was like a yellow oxide, kind of yellow ochre color. And so those were the Conti crayons, and then everybody else went with it and figured out how they could make dyes. And this is how colored pencils were invented. Isn't that a great story? I love that. Okay. The hell class. And so we brought it full circle. So you see, we just used those few colors, and we came up with this. I mean, this isn't, I mean, I'm not saying this is a, you know, total masterpiece of brilliance here with our pencils, but maybe we'll do something like this, and we'll come under here like this, and we'll dry brush onto our like this, and suggest that there might be some sort of reflections going on here. That might be fun. If I started this up higher, we could have had some fun times with this. Yes, but you know, I mean, this was never intended to be much of a painting. Where's scissors? Where did I put scissors? I'm looking for scissors. I put them somewhere clever. This is a small desk. I had them. You all saw me. I had them. I had scissors. Everybody can attest to the fact that I had scissors. I did. I had scissors. Oh, I see. I see. Okay, so I'm just going to take my T-square like this. What am I going to do? I'm going to take my T-square like this. Draw a little line like this. And I'm going to say this is my, I don't know, I'm going to just end this picture right here. I love, a little bookmark or something. A little bookmark, something like that. Okay. Now, you see, now, yes. Somebody asked the question, what size canvas do I tend to paint the paintings that I sell? Well, if you go to my website that shows my original artwork, gingercookstudios.com, you'll see all, usually 30 by 40, 36 by 48, 48, 60, occasionally some 16 by 20, but very few. Mostly I do very, very large canvases. And, you know, that's what galleries want to hang, and that's what people will, you know, buy that, you know, what size canvases do I use, okay? And that would be the size. So, let's see, I want to just fix this a little bit. All right, whenever you're doing a pencil, you've got, nothing ever sharpens perfectly, so you've got to bring a little raggedy edge down onto the pencil into that. Okay, just going to say that. Let's see, it's a little more bright yellow, second coat of yellow here, okay? So those are our three pencils. And then you could write something on here. You're going like what? Well, for instance, if you were making like a little bookmark or something like this, you could write, I don't know. Am I selling my hair dryer? No. But okay, I mean, I could write my name on here and then maybe some titles of things or members of the family. I don't know. Just we can have fun with this. This is a little Uniball pen. It's a fun little ginger snap. I'll tell you, what I really wanted to happen was I thought that if the art stores carried hair, listen, if the art store had any kind of hair dryer like this, we'd all go buy one, right? I mean, I don't know why nobody makes these for that. I mean, this took me about an hour to paint. If you watched my video Starry Night, just take the same paints out that you did before, right? That you're doing with Starry Night. It's on YouTube. Thing is, you've got to have another hair dryer to dry this. So in order to make this work, you've got to have two. You got to have one that dries this as you go. And then, and you can see I did it a little differently on both sides. We were all talking about different things you could have. I just thought Starry Night was nice. And, you know, what's cool is that, you know, I can move this around. Now, check it out. It works on both sides. Are you impressed? Look at that. See? Look at that. That was on purpose, too. So if I turn that over and it works on this side like that, see? So, I mean, I thought this was kind of neat because you can... You know, you can change I like these little ends on this hairdryer. And if you want to know where I bought this hairdryer was $15 at Costco. And it was originally $20 and I had a coupon. But these are wonderful hairdryers. And it's got a cold button, has really lots of blast of heat, had a really long cord, has a nice, and it wasn't bad. I bought one for my hair and I liked it so well, I went ahead and bought another one for painting because I thought they were pretty reasonable. And I really like it. So that's where I got it. And it was purple. So it wasn't a big stretch to paint it. And I noticed that people said, well, does the paint stick to it? And yeah, it does. Because I had all this paint. Well, you can tell from the court, everything is sticking to everything. Look here. Yeah, the paint doesn't seem to have any trouble sticking to it. And then what you have to do. Now, this is important. When you're doing something like this, like someone says, well, it's scratch or chip. This is gloss, medium, and varnish. And I did two coats. I will do two more. And if you're doing any kind of children's furniture where the kids are going to get to it and color on top of something, like, you know, six coats. You know, really. And then maybe some shellac if it's children's furniture to really seal it in. Because what happens is this gloss, medium, and varnish, it doesn't sit on top like oil painting varnish. It molecularly binds to all these things and makes like a complete blanket of... All this stuff is now fused. All these colors are all fused because of this. All right, so we got a little bookmark here. That's cute, right? A little bookmark out of colored pencils, and you could like write some clever things on here. We don't know what you'd write, but you ought to be able to write something wonderful for books. Yes, we have another question. Well, this is the thing. Someone says, how can I tell if colors are harmonious? Well, that's what the color wheel is for. For instance, like if you put, for instance, a dark blue and a light red, you know, violet and a light violet, those are real pretty. You know, and those look really nice together. Here, if you're really confused about colors, go out and buy this one. This color wheel, it's made by the same company, was designed, it's called Creative Color Wheel. It's designed for quilters. But basically, when you turn this around, if you're not sure what's going to look good, all these colors are going to look great with those. Okay? So if you kept these colors in your quilt or your painting, you'd be in good shape. And the same thing over here. If you're getting, you can see this kind of follows around to this. And kind of the lights and darks of how you might shade it. Now, the trick is, do you know how to make all those? For instance, how are you going to make this pretty red-violet color? Okay? Now, that's a question. How are you going to make that? Well, guess what, dear friends? You ain't. You're not going to take red and white and make any kind of violet. You just are not. This is one of these, because red's a primary color, what you have to do is you have to buy something called magenta. I'll put a little bit of this out for you. And so if you're, and here's magenta, and here's some white. See, you see that? And that's a really beautiful, bright color. All right, and that's really nice. For instance, you can see where I've got some magenta in this picture. All right, can't you? But for instance, if I took just naphthol crimson, which is your primary red, that's your main red on the color wheel, okay? And I added white to that. We talk about that in Adventures in Red, but I think sometimes it helps to just bring the point home about this stuff. if you take a little bit of white and a little bit of red and you get a pink, you see, you do get a pink, but it is not purpley. Do you see that? Can you see that? Ooh, zoom in. Can you see the difference in the color? Now, sadly, you know, women see more shades of red than men do, but there is a difference between this and this. So if you're trying to get this sort of bright, almost, I want to call it a Pepto-Bismol pink kind of, you know, this magenta pink, you've got to buy magenta. And the same thing with, now we had some purple, but you're going, well, wait a minute, red and blue make purple. Couldn't I just add some blue to the red? And wouldn't that give it to me? So let's take a little red, a little phthalo blue, a little bit of white. Whoops, let's try a little more color here. We kind of ran out of, cannot do a demonstration if you don't have enough color out. Let's see, we put white somewhere. Yeah, okay. So here, I'll put a little more white out so you can see what I speak. So I'm going to just, we put red and blue together. I'm going to add some more white to that. And I'm getting kind of a purple. And let's add a little bit more red. And I'm getting sort of a purple, a little more red. Okay, now this is what I'm getting over here. And you see, it's not as bright. Might make a nice shadow color for a flower, but it's just never going to be as bright as this. So whenever you mix a color, it will never be as bright as what you buy out of the tube. Okay, and that would be the best way I could explain it. Now if I had used, what about if I used Dasein purple? What would happen then? Well, let's see, do I have any Dasein purple and I have it mixed with something else? Well, try that out. You won't get it, but the only way you'll really appreciate that is if you do it yourself. You know, here's some Dasein purple, okay, and you can see how much brighter it is. It's just a brighter color than you can mix, all right? And if I add a little bit of red to that, it is not going to give me this bright magenta. It's just will be still toned down. So that's one of the reasons why you want to buy it. And I would suggest invest in a few color wheels. This one is called the Creative Color Wheel. And it was designed to help you so you wouldn't have to think about it. You could just start spinning the wheel around. You say, okay, I'm going to use these orange colors, and what else can I put in the picture? All right. In fact, this whole painting was designed using, let me zoom back out. This whole painting was designed using this color wheel and picking the colors for my flowers. See, I've got these pretty blue flowers down in here. I've got this nice orange. This whole painting was designed off of this color wheel. Because as you recall, we just had a black and white photo of that. All right, this was our ginger stamp for the day. And I think, yeah, I think this would make a very nice bookmark. Put a little, little hole right there, a little tab, and there you go. You got a bookmark, colored pencil bookmark. But you do have to write some stuff on there. And that's where paint pens come in. This is where you want paint pens or Sharpies or things like that that come in. It can be very nice. Here's some paint pens from Liquitex. These are actually paint markers from Liquitex. And for instance, like here's a, let me just shake that up. When you get these, there's a little ball inside and they want you to shake these up for like an hour or something. I don't know, it just takes forever to shake these up. You just gotta shake it and shake it and shake it. But now, if I were gonna do any writing on this yellow one, I would probably use this blue pen. Now see the pen here? I have to sit here and do this 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 until the paint comes out. See there? And then I might come along here and watch out. Also, give me something to write, John. I need some help here. Spell it for me. Okay, I'm gonna write this. Wait till I see. Sounds very egotistical here, but this is what I'm writing. This is called a gingerism, okay? Gingerisms are the style of painting we do sometimes. This is a gingerism, okay? I mean, I'm just making this up, but I mean, this is what, but you see the blue looked kind of nice on the yellow, didn't it? So, you know, because again, we sort of tied it in here. And again, if you're having trouble, paint pens are lovely. This is real acrylic paint. You can buy these, and they look kind of neat. Now, what do you do once you have the pen? What is the big secret? You take a piece of this tape. This is real important. If you don't do this, you just might as well light the money on fire. Take a piece of tape and start wrapping around your pen like this and seal this. because once the air gets to it, it dries and it's acrylic paint. You know what happens when you dry acrylic paint on your brushes, right? It just makes a rock, right? Cement. And then fold the tape back like this and make yourself a tab so that you can get the tape off. There's your tab with your pen, okay? And then here, do I have any other pens? I thought I saw one. What was this one? Did I have another pen? Oh yeah, here. Okay, so here's a yellow pen. And I might have put something up on there, maybe yellow. It might have been cute up on this orange. Again, you can just, these are just fun things to do. I think this is going to be a great fun painting. Now you know the tricks. This took a lot of drawing and taping and drawing and taping, I can tell you that. That painting took a little bit of time. But again, when you look at the color wheel, see how pretty that is? And I think it came out much more fun than this one, even though I really quite liked the photograph. I mean, I like that, but I didn't want all this. Who wants all these labels and stuff? That didn't appeal to me at all. And I wanted to just sort of change the colors a bit, deliberately think about where we were putting the colors. So there we go. And I think this is our 20 minutes. This is a 20-minute cookie crumb from Ginger Cook. I'm hoping, before I quit, just know that this week's lesson we're releasing Thursday is this old-time gas station called Pop Store. And so tomorrow, right? Isn't this cool? This will be in our lesson library for our members. Our members, if you're new and you've never heard of me, you go to gingercooklive.gallery, which I got to do a quick ad for, right? Like gallery, and you go over there, and it's all inclusive, including an art coach for $24.95 a month. There's nobody on the internet offers anything close to that. Your friends will tell you, our members will tell you, it's like great. And I love it when you send me paintings, and I can make a comment on it, but through email, and send it back, and you come back and you change it, and we get some real masterpieces. And it's a really great way to take lessons, and you can be global. You don't have to live near me. And every week we release something different. Now, this particular lesson on the colored pencils will stay up. Monday night lessons stay up. Our weekly lessons are only up, like tomorrow night will be up for an hour. They only stay up for the time of the broadcast plus about 4 hours. And then we remove them and they end up on our website for our members. So our members get 3 new lessons a week. And this was what we had last week, was this was the release, the photographer. So some of you wanted to tackle that. And we have that. And I understand we're painting a lot more lessons than you would normally do. This is great fun. Now, somebody said, what if I have a lot of paint and I want to paint tomorrow? You can mist your paint and then get a wet sponge, like a little wet sponge, and put it there and stick this in some sort of airtight container. This would probably be good tomorrow if you want to keep your paint. If you were just feeling like you put out too much and you just wish you hadn't, that's okay. That's one way to keep it. And we have found scissors. We have found paint pens. We have learned all kinds of great stuff. So thanks for watching. And plus, I told you how to make this hair dryer. Right? So being really. This was an action. John says this was action packed. I mean, you got some information here, you guys. And listen, likes. This is going to stay up on YouTube. So likes and comments are appreciated. That helps other people. The more comments and likes we get, it helps other people find these lessons on YouTube. It's part of the algorithm. They notice that. YouTube notices that, and it makes a difference to us. And also, I want to give a shout-out to my daughter, Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa, who made 50,000 subscribers this week, which is huge. Last year at this time, she was at 6,000, and she's done 50,000. So we got to give her big kudos to Cinnamon for that. And I can't wait to see the rest of her blogs from her trip to New York last week, because she had a time. You know, they got there and they had a hotel reservations and the hotel had never heard of them. It was crazy. So she'll have to tell you about that. So that was our story about the pencils. Great fun. And yes, one last question. Oh gosh, this is the question. Can you put paint in a freezer? It's not recommended, no. In fact, somebody asked me the other day, what happened to the brown paint? In fact, I'm almost convinced, and this is, boy, I gotta be careful what I say, because these paint companies have these tests that they do, and I don't know what planet they live on, but the tests don't, I do not get the same results. How's that? Ginger does not get the same results. Let me tell you, brown is one of the most sensitive colors to cold ever. In fact, I'm almost convinced that one should buy one's paint in the spring and the fall, where when they're on the truck, they're not subject to any real hot weather or any real cold weather, because who knows where it's coming from. and if or where the truck got stalled in the middle of a blizzard in the middle of who knows where, because promise you, I don't think it does well with cold. Now you can check it on an airplane. It's pretty cold. It's pretty cold in an airplane cargo hold, but generally you do not want to freeze your paint, and you don't want to cook it either. Okay, unlike Conti, who was willing to take the the mud color and the mud and clay and wax. Did I mention he used wax? Put all that in a pot, and he made Conte crayons with his stuff. Basically, we don't cook it. How's that? Thanks. I'm done. Good night, guys. Thanks for watching. Happy Memorial Day for those of you who are in the States that are watching. Okay, so you stopped the stream, right?